Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. India has decided to walk out from the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. So we have two articles in today's newspaper. We have an article on page number 1 and we also have a column on page number 11. So first let us understand what is the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. See, the RCEP is a proposed free trade agreement which involved 16 countries of the Indo-Pacific region. But now that India has walked out, the number of countries has fallen to 15. So the countries which were a part of the RCEP negotiations included the 10 Southeast Asian countries of the ASEAN group. It included China, South Korea, Japan, Australia, New Zealand, and of course, India. These 16 countries constitute the largest economies of the Indo-Pacific region, and they decided to set up a free trade area known as the RCEP during the 2012 ASEAN summit, which was held in Cambodia. If this free trade area was established, it was all set to become the world's largest free trade agreement, both in terms of population and as well as in terms of GDP. So the negotiations to set up the RCEP officially began in 2012 and it has been going on for more than 7 years. The key pillar of RCEP is the ASEAN group, which represents the 10 Southeast Asian countries. The ASEAN group has successfully established a common market for these 10 Southeast Asian countries and it has extended this model to these 6 countries as well by signing a separate FTA with each one of them. In fact, these 16 countries are already a part of a grouping known as the ASEAN Plus 6, which meets on the sidelines of the annual ASEAN summit. So by considering the tremendous economic potential of these 16 countries, a proposal was made during the 2012 ASEAN summit to establish a free trade area known as the RCEP. See, if you look at the 10 ASEAN countries, they are largely export-oriented. A few countries have a strong manufacturing base, especially in electronics and automobiles. Then you have a few strong players in agricultural exports, and you also have few market leaders in services. For example, Vietnam and Indonesia, they are major exporters of agricultural products. Then if you look at Singapore, it's a market leader in financial and legal services. Then you have China, which is a global economic powerhouse, and again, its economy is export-oriented. It has a very strong manufacturing base in multiple sectors, and it also represents a very big market. Then you have South Korea, which is again an export-oriented economy, and it has a strong manufacturing base, especially in electronics and automobiles. Next, we have India, which is not an export-driven economy, but it is definitely one of the major players in services, especially in information technology, banking, etc. It is also a major player in agricultural exports, and it is also quite significant in few sectors of manufacturing. Upon this, India is a rich source for skilled manpower and human resource. Indian professionals are widely sought after in various sectors such as banking, finance, information technology, biotech, etc. Then we have Japan, Australia and New Zealand, which are developed economies. And Japan again is an export-oriented economy with a very strong manufacturing base in electronics, automobiles and various other sectors. And Australia and New Zealand, they are major players with regard to a variety of services. And they are one of the leading countries with regard to agricultural exports, especially dairy exports. So the objective of the RCEP was to exploit this economic potential of the 16 largest economies of the Indo-Pacific region in order to establish the world's largest free trade area. See, a free trade agreement is basically trying to promote free movement of goods, services, investment and people. In order to achieve this objective, it is trying to establish a common market by reducing or by eliminating the barriers to trade. When we say barriers to trade, it refers to tariff-based barriers and non-tariff barriers. Tariff-based barriers includes taxes such as import duties and custom duties. Non-tariff barriers includes strict immigration laws, lack of infrastructure, poor connectivity, and poor logistics. These are the factors which can inhibit trade, and they act as barriers to trade. So a free trade agreement is basically trying to reduce these barriers in order to establish a common market and provide for the free movement of goods, services, investment, and people. See, the concept of a free trade area is a part of liberal market theory, which believes in liberalization and globalization. The proponents of this theory believe that if there is more liberalization and globalization, and if there is greater reduction of barriers to trade, then it will benefit both the domestic industry and as well as the foreign industry. So if a FTA is well negotiated, and if all the members have adopted a policy of give and take, and if they have struck a compromise, then it will create a win-win situation for all the members. In this case, the domestic industry will also stand to benefit along with the foreign players. A well-negotiated FTA will open up new markets to the domestic industry, and this can significantly increase the exports of a country. This in turn can create large-scale employment opportunities as well. And a well-negotiated FTA will also help the foreign players as well. It will provide ample opportunities for good quality cheap imports, which in turn can promote a healthy competition between the domestic industry and the foreign players. But on the other hand, if a FTA is not well negotiated and if it is one-sided, it can work to the disadvantage of the weaker economies. It can actually benefit the stronger economies, and it can pose a grave threat to the domestic industry of weaker economies. Such poorly negotiated one-sided FTAs can result in the flooding of our domestic markets by cheap imports which are coming in from the stronger economies. It can also result in unfair market access for our producers and manufacturers. This threat posed to the domestic industry raises the call for protectionist measures such as the imposition of higher import duties, higher custom duties, and it also raises the call for the imposition of countervailing duties and anti-dumping duties. The best example to illustrate the impact of such poorly negotiated FTAs has to be the FTA that India has signed with the ASEAN, with Japan, and with South Korea. According to reports, the India-ASEAN FTA has had a huge impact on domestic coffee and coconut production in India. Similarly, India's FTA with Japan and South Korea has had a huge impact on the domestic electronics, engineering, and automobile sector. So during the RCEP negotiations, similar concerns have come up which could have a significant impact on India's domestic producers and manufacturers. So this has pushed the Indian government to walk out of the RCEP negotiations. Prime Minister Modi, who was participating in the RCEP summit, has flagged these concerns as the reasons behind India's decision to walk out of the RCEP arrangement. The Prime Minister has said that the terms proposed by the other 15 members of the RCEP would have a significant impact on Indian farmers because of the flooding of cheap agricultural imports from Southeast Asia and as well as the flooding of cheap dairy products from New Zealand. Similar concerns have been expressed for India's industry, especially the MSME sector as well, because the domestic industry could take a significant hit because of the flooding of cheap imports from manufacturing powerhouses such as China, South Korea, Japan, and the ASEAN countries. According to the Indian government, sectors such as electronics, engineering, and automobiles would have taken a significant hit if India had accepted the terms proposed by the RCEP negotiations. Then India has also refused to provide for stricter intellectual property laws as mandated by developed countries such as Australia, New Zealand, and Japan. See, with regard to IP laws, developed countries always push for a strict implementation in order to benefit their companies. But these demands are always resisted by the developing countries in order to protect their domestic industry. In this case, the terms of the RCEP would have affected the pharmaceutical sector, which is one of the strongest sectors in the Indian economy, because strict implementation of IP laws could affect the production of generic drugs. Currently, India stands as a market leader with regard to production of generic drugs. This standing of India could be affected if India had become a part of RCEP. Apart from this, India has been unhappy about the stringent immigration laws of countries such as Singapore, Australia, New Zealand, Japan, etc., which has affected the movement of Indian professionals. So by citing these concerns, India has decided to walk out of the free trade agreement, but the other 15 countries will be going ahead and finalizing the RCEP deal by the end of this year, so that the RCEP will come into effect from 2020 onwards. But the option to join in the future will always remain open for India, because the other 15 countries realize the significance of the Indian economy in the Indo-Pacific region. The other 15 countries are well aware of the tremendous economic opportunities that are offered by India's vast market. They realize the significance of India's skilled manpower and professionals who can contribute to their economy. They also understand India's strength in agriculture and services. So that's the reason why they have kept the option open for India to join the RCEP in the future, so that the world's largest FTA can live up to its true potential. Next, in the column on page number 11, the writer makes an argument as to why India should have joined the RCEP. First, he understands the concerns that have been expressed by the Indian government. The Indian government has been naturally worried about the impact of RCEP on the domestic sector, because India already has a trade deficit with 11 out of 15 of these countries. The Indian government was worried that the RCEP would open the floodgates to cheap imports from China, South Korea, and other countries, which would further increase this trade deficit. Next, the government and the Indian industry are well aware of the weakness and the critical flaws that are inherent in the Indian economy. They know very well that in its current state, the Indian economy could never compete with the manufacturing powerhouses of China, ASEAN region, Japan, South Korea, etc. These concerns are natural and understandable, because India is not an export-oriented economy and it is not a manufacturing-oriented economy. But the writer says that India could have aspired to become one by joining the RCEP and by capitalizing the opportunities that were being presented by the free trade agreement. The writer refers to the theories of liberal economists, and he says that the competition that would have been generated by the RCEP would have pushed the Indian government and the Indian industry to innovate, and this could have initiated structural economic reforms which could have transformed the Indian economy into an export-oriented economy with a strong manufacturing base. The next impact of not joining the RCEP would be on India's Act East policy. Under the Act East policy, India has ambitiously projected a role for itself in the Indo-Pacific region. The Indo-Pacific region has emerged as a global hub for geopolitics, and India seeks to play a key role in this region. Under its Act East policy, it has already made considerable strategic, diplomatic, and military investments into the region. But without significant economic involvement, India's role in the Indo-Pacific will become irrelevant and inconsequential. So by citing these grounds, the writer says that India should have joined the RCEP and it should have become a part of Asia's trade regionalism by keeping in mind the long-term interests even at the cost of short-term losses. Now let's take up a column from the editorial page. The column written by Neera Chandoke calls for a rights-based framework to fight against poverty. This column has been written in the context of an interesting debate that has broken out over the question of fighting poverty in the backdrop of this year's Nobel Prize in Economics, which has been awarded to Abhijit Banerjee, his wife Esther Duflo, and Michael Kerner. The Nobel Prize in Economics has been awarded to them in recognition of their path-breaking work in the field of developmental economics and for pioneering randomized controlled trials, which have proved to be effective in poverty alleviation and welfare programs. In this context, an interesting debate has come up, which is centered around the question, what is the best way to fight poverty? So as a follow-up to this debate, the writer talks about the political theories that were developed by Western philosophers in the 1980s. During this period, poverty and suffering was raging in third world countries, and Western philosophers came out with a number of political theories to fight against poverty. This theoretical and philosophical debate came to be known as the global justice debate. Under this movement, a number of poverty alleviation theories were floated, but most of them were centered around charity, philanthropy, generosity, etc. Under this debate, Western philosophers popularized the notion that the Western countries, especially the elite in the Western countries, they owed it to the poor people in the third world countries. Under the global justice debate, the notion of fighting poverty was reduced to charity and generosity from the West. These theories of elite Western philosophers was driven by their own guilt, their passion to help the poor, and by their failure to understand the root causes of poverty in a society. The main trigger for the global justice debate was the impact of economic policies of liberalization and globalization that was enforced by the IMF, the World Bank, and later by the WTO on failed economies of the 1980s and 1990s. By the 1980s, a number of newly born countries had started to fail because of the long-lasting impact of colonialism. So when these countries approached the IMF and the World Bank for assistance, they were forced to implement liberalization and globalization. And this in turn pushed millions of people into poverty around the world. And it also resulted in the breakout of riots around the world, which are popularly referred to as the anti-IMF riots. Ironically, the global justice debate was entirely focused on the poverty and suffering caused by the policies of these institutions, by ignoring the root cause, which is colonialism. So the writer uses this as an example to illustrate our flawed understanding of poverty. The writer says that poverty is not just an outcome of policies, but it is an outcome of the injustice, inequality, and the lack of opportunities that are prevalent in our societies. These factors are found in every society, and they create poverty not just in third world countries, but they also cause poverty in the developed West. See, generally, we believe that poverty is just a result of inadequate income. But this is our flawed understanding, because poverty is an outcome of our environment and surroundings. It is a direct outcome of the injustice, inequality, and the lack of opportunities that are prevalent in our society. These factors not only cause poverty, but they also establish it as a vicious cycle. For example, if you look at the vulnerable sections in the Indian society, that is the Dalits, the scheduled tribes, religious minorities, etc., they report a higher share of poverty, and it is a direct outcome of the injustice and inequality which is prevalent in the Indian society. So when these sections are not given equal access to resources, when they are not given equal opportunities, it further pushes them into deprivation. This turns them into a mere vote bank for the political parties. And they are further subjected to injustice and disrespect at the hands of the upper class. And as a result, it restricts their participation in the social, cultural, and economic transactions of the society. So this establishes the vicious cycle of poverty. The one who is deprived finds it nearly impossible to access good quality education, good quality healthcare, nutritious food, etc. And as a result, the poverty continues as a cycle. So the writer says that if these root causes of poverty have to be fought, then we do not need charity or generosity. What we need is a rights-based framework. These rights should be defined through our constitution, through our laws, and through our government policies. These policies should be designed to provide for equitable sharing of resources and redistribution of wealth, irrespective of one's social status. They should be designed to provide for fair opportunities by keeping in mind the social oppression that the poor communities might have faced. According to the writer, poverty can be fought only with such a rights-based framework. And some of these features are already a part of the Indian constitution and as well as India's socio-economic welfare programs. Now let's take up another column from the editorial page. The column written by Dr. Soham makes a case for seamlessly fusing traditional medicine with modern medicine. The writer talks about the need to revive traditional Indian systems of medicine, that is Ayush, which includes Ayurveda, Yoga, Yunani, Siddha, and Homeopathy. First, the writer highlights how the traditional systems of Indian medicine became a cultural factor in promoting the spirit of nationalism during the freedom struggle. But later, these traditional forms of medicine, they lost their relevance and significance, and unfortunately, it even became subservient to modern allopathic medicine. See, over the years, the government of India has taken a number of steps in order to mainstream the Ayush form of traditional medicine. Today, we have a dedicated ministry for Ayush. There are separate Ayush wings in defense and railway hospitals. The government is also providing loans and subsidies for establishing private Ayush clinics. And Ayush has also been given a primary role in a number of government healthcare programs such as Ayushman Bharat. But despite these efforts, the status of Ayush traditional medicine has always remained subservient to that of modern Western allopathic medicine. But at the same time, there are genuine concerns about the quality of Ayush traditional medicine that is being offered in the country. See, Western allopathic medicine has always questioned the efficacy and the scientific validity of traditional medicine. Some of these questions have been raised on genuine grounds because in traditional medicine, you will find that there are a large number of quack doctors who are operating. And a number of treatments and services that are offered under traditional medicine, they suffer from lack of standardization and lack of scientific inquiry, and this is a direct outcome of the poor regulation of the sector. So as a result, traditional forms of medicine is generally ridiculed and challenged by practitioners of allopathic medicine, and as a result, it has acquired a subservient status. But if you impartially evaluate the treatments and practices under Ayush, you will find that at least some of them are rooted in solid scientific evidence and they offer tremendous health benefits as compared to allopathic medicine. Plus, the traditional forms of medicine under Ayush has wide reach in India and it can supplement the reach of allopathic medicine and it can help the government to provide for universal coverage of health and wellness. So considering the potential of traditional medicine, the responsibility of the government should be to promote a seamless fusion of traditional medicine with modern medicine. And the government of India should draw a lesson from China's experience because since the 1950s, China has successfully promoted the fusion of its traditional medicine with Western allopathic medicine. So the government can achieve this by promoting the integration of Ayush into the education and research of allopathic medicine. It needs to promote the training of practitioners of both forms of medicine so that they are sensitized to each other's practices and concerns. It should integrate the learning of Ayush forms of medicine into allopathic courses by providing for scientific revision of curriculum, and it should also provide for the standardization of procedures, treatment and drugs. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following statements are correct? The Chiang Mai Initiative is a multilateral currency swap arrangement amongst the 10 members of the ASEAN. This is a wrong statement because it includes not just the ASEAN, but it includes the ASEAN plus 3. The ASEAN plus 3 includes the 10 Southeast Asian countries of the ASEAN group plus China, plus Japan and South Korea. Kindly note this down. So the Chiang Mai Initiative is a multilateral currency swap arrangement involving the ASEAN plus 3. The second statement says it was set up in the aftermath of the 2008 financial crisis. This is again a wrong statement. It was set up after the 1997 Asian financial crisis. It was set up because these countries wanted to reduce their dependency on the International Monetary Fund. So both the statements are incorrect. Option D is the right answer. Now let us take up the second question. Which article of the Indian Constitution provides for the prevention of concentration of wealth? The correct answer is option B, Article 39. This is a part of Directive Principles of State Policy, and this article says that the government and its economic policies should be designed in such a way so that it can prevent the undue concentration of wealth in the hands of few. Now let us take up the next question. The Bharat Stage Emission Standards applies for automobile manufacturers and oil refiners. Option B is the correct answer. Now let us take up a map-based question. The Kra Isthmus is located in Thailand. Option D is the correct answer. Please look at the map. This is where the Kra Isthmus is located. It is the narrowest point in the Malay Peninsula and it is a part of southern Thailand. This area is very important because China has proposed to build the Kra Canal, which seeks to connect the Andaman Sea with the South China Sea by bypassing the Strait of Malacca, which is a strategic choke point for China. Now let us take up a practice question from the 2015 prelims paper. Who of the following organized a march on the Tanjore coast to break the salt law in April 1930? The correct answer is option B. It was C. Rajagopalachari. This salt march is also known as the Vedaranyam March. This was an extension of the Dandi March that was initiated by Mahatma Gandhi. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, critically evaluate the fallout for India for not signing the RCEP agreement. The second question, discuss the various determinants of poverty and how best can they be overcome. Kindly write an answer to these questions and post them in the comment section below. This concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.